Welcome back, and for the first time ever, the sun did not shine on the face of the great pharaoh, Ramses the II. The sun rays were supposed to be aligned in a straight line over the Abu Simbel Temple Holy of the Holy Shrine in Aswan, Upper Egypt, lasting for 20 minutes. However, for the first time ever, this did not happen, as it was very cloudy day. The shrine inside one of Abu Simbel's two temples includes four-seated statues that were carved from the stone. The temples date back to the reign of Pharaoh Ramses II and were built and aligned so that the sun rays fall perpendicularly to perfectly illuminate Ramses II's statues twice a year. Naveen.
Good morning, Mr. We have with us, of course, today Mr. Bassam Shama'a, Egyptologist. Thank you for joining us, and good morning, sir. And as Dina said, this is the first time that the sun rays does not shine on the Pharaoh Ramses II. Would you please explain to us why this occurred this year and it hasn't ever occurred previously?
Well, the 22nd of Feb marked, at least to a guy like me who's modestly reading history for the last 34 years, something that I never experienced before. So for the last 34 years, that I can confirm that what happened is in the whole event of not illuminating, that is the first time that I experienced or I heard of or I read of. Also in the books that I maybe read, or half or quarter of a book that I read, I didn't read anybody documenting an event like that. So for me, as an Egyptian, not as a guy who's in history, that's the first time that I heard about something like this. So we are now not talking about anything in the temple. We're not talking about the carving, we're not talking about the angle of alignment with the sun rays, we're not talking about the 60 meters that the sun rays takes from the entrance all the way to the sanctuary, the illumination on the three statues and not the fourth, all the things, all the genius things that we used to and still explain about what happens on twice a year, as we all know, that has got nothing to do with what happened. Cloudy day, very possible, probably the only possibility that I can think of, weather-like, climate-wise.
Also, it's a climate problem. It's an issue only with the climate.
That's what I think. If you are talking about fog, if you're talking about, if you like, watery fog, if you're talking about the business of the sun rays were not allowed through the clouds, that's something that we experienced that day even in Cairo. Right. When we were experiencing how the clouds were everywhere and sun rays used to come down. Mm-hmm. But in many other cases, that was linked to some of the words and the sentences and the phrases which were used by maybe the minister, and that was a chance and by chance, yeah, and all of this. Well, the guy said that I didn't say it's by chance. I said the others are by chance, and the only one which is not by chance is Abu Simbel.
Mr. Bassam, what happened exactly? Is it cloudy? Is it winter?
I believe yes. Happened? I believe yes, because I don't believe anything happened in the mountain, because it is another proposition that the mountain moved. We will remember that alignment used to happen on the 21st of Feb, and then 21st of October. And then when they raised the temple's 64 meters above its original level, and then deep inside more meters, so you played now with the longitude and altitude and all of this.
But the pharaohs were punctual, meticulous, and they are professional calculations.
Yes.
So why this incident happened?
First of all, why did it change? Why did the date change? Change because you moved it. You moved the temples from its original bed, if you like. Mm. But you were very keen when you were moving it in the 60s to make it more or less with the angles of alignment so that you don't lose this. And Emilia Edwards, many years ago, wrote her 1,000 miles by the Nile, or on the Nile. She mentioned some cases of that alignment. So, yes, we are believing that something happened with the climate, and it's got nothing to do with the movement of the mountains. Mm. But when you ask me, mountains move? Because that was also mentioned, and I was asked by some press, some people on the Facebook are writing that the mountain moved. Well, yes, mountains move. Yes, we know that for sure. And many people wrote about that. Remember when I made here the genius of the Islamic scientists, I mentioned a guy mentioned that India moved. And so 1,000 years AD, that study is made and proven. Yes, grounds move. But even if it moved, in our case, in the case of Abu Simbel, it's not going to move that dramatically to change the alignment that big. Mm. Others will tell you that maybe the sun alignment happened one day before, some people mentioned one day before the show, and some people will tell you also that perhaps it will happen on the 23rd of February. That's something I can accept, that I can accept easily. But you have to remember that the alignment should be, when you say alignment on the three statues of the century, they should be full alignment, full illumination, because sometimes it can be late, some minutes. 2009, it was late, but then it happened. Mm-hmm. But not to happen at all, that is a case.
Mm-hmm. What's the difference then between the sun being perpendicular on his face in October and in February? What's the difference between the two dates?
Thank you for asking, because for years, all press and I don't know who and students and universities would teach that those are the two special days for Rabi Caesar II. The man, as we all know, took power when he was 25 and he died 89 to 90 years of age, perhaps 91, and with arthritis and others, and maybe with some problems with the back. And they said that those are the 2 days that he's celebrating in there with the sun, because he's the son of the sun.
Right.
Because Ra Meses, Ra Misu, Ra Mes, Mesu, Mes, Mes means the sun, S-O-N. And Ra is the sun, S-U-N. So he's the son of Ra. He's the begotten of Ra. Ra got him, brought him. Right, so he's making that relation with the deities, and that's why he is seated shoulder to shoulder in the most amazing, see, because many people would be concentrating with the illumination, but you have to see the symbolism of that. The symbolism of that is dangerous. Ramesses II is doing something dangerous in this temple of sitting shoulder to shoulder with the deities. Hello, you should wait until you die so that you can change into a full deity, because during your lifetime you are a demigod or a half deity. But no, not Ramesses II. Ramesses II says, I'm not going to wait until I die to become a god. I'm going to be a deity now. And he puts himself with Rahuakhti on his side, even Ra, that we wrongly call him Amun Ra, and Ptah, the one on the far left when you are looking at. That one is not illuminated. So, 3 out of 4 statues get illuminated twice a year, so they directly would tell you that amazing myth that this is the day of his birthday and this is the day of his throne. So mounting, when he actually mounted the throne of Egypt and the day that's celebrating his birthday. Totally.
Right.
150% wrong. Mm-hmm. We don't have one text in ancient Egypt, or even a sign, or something symbolic that tells us that those 2 days has got anything to do with him mounting the throne, and the other one is his birthday. Because, I will tell you at the end of this answering this question, is that we know for sure that in Pharaoh Triumphant, it's amazing work by Professor Kitchen, and if anybody is listening or watching us now, I shall recommend highly that you read this work of Kitchen, a professor called Kitchen, Triumphant Pharaoh Ramesses II, amazing work. And he's telling us that the man took power the 27th of June, third month of the summer season. See how particular how accurate is this? And after dawn, I was expecting him to tell me about 7:30 in the morning, right? So now for sure we know that he's a June guy. It's nothing to do with February, nothing to do with October.
Okay, Mr. Bassam, such a phenomena, why we are not taking advantage of this event internationally? Maybe the number of tourists who comes to Egypt for this event only may cover the whole year. So what Egypt should do to use such an event worldwide?
Absolutely. You are not using 1%. Yes, we heard about 4,000 people, yes, but how many tourists, how many people came, the 4,000. Mm-hmm. Two, we really should and could change this business of the celebrations. I mean, not every year, the same, I don't know who, the same dances, and I do not know what's the relation between a girl wearing short skirts jumping in front of a temple doing with the event. What's the relation? Mm-hmm. Why are we doing this? There is nothing, you are talking about culture here. We're not talking about girls in short skirts. We're talking about culture. Mm-hmm. So this culture should be celebrated in a different way. And I told the governor one day here in this building, in Maspero, in Good Morning Egypt. And he said, oh, brilliant ideas. Nothing. I said, lectures one day before, the night. Lectures to everybody. Whoever is not in Abu Simbel, lectures will be transported and this on TV, on air. Telling everybody in different languages what this phenomena is all about. Because you don't expect everybody in Abu Simbel to have a guide and to have a guy who's explaining and this. The people need to understand. there are things, there are studies made now, but things that you're not going to believe. We have Mr. Ahmed, one of our famous Egyptologists now, a young, very, very promising Egyptologist that I know. He's now talking about, why do we have 22 baboons on the frieze? See how articulate is that? Mm-hmm. Why is the fourth guy never get illuminated? Ptah, the fourth guy on the left. Why is he not illuminated? Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about this year. I'm talking about ever. Mm-hmm. Because Ptah shouldn't illuminate. This is not a mistake made by the ancient Egyptian carvers who carved the temple. Ptah is part of the 12 hours of the night in the mythology. So if Ptah get illuminated, the whole phenomena would be wrong. That will wrong the phenomena.
Right. Mr. Shama'a, you promised us with a surprise in this episode. So we're waiting for the surprise.
Right. What I'm about to say, because guys, they don't know what I brought, right? So we didn't talk. We told us, I'm not going to tell you. What you're about to hear now, everybody, you are about to hear the most amazing phenomena here, because the phenomena didn't happen. Well, I brought you another phenomena, so don't despair. And you are going to hear the trumpet of Tutankhamun being blown strongly and healthily in the 1930s AD, first time to blow air in it since 1300s BC. So you are talking about a good thousands of years that this trumpet was never used.
This the one that was stolen during the
You had two in the tomb, right? We had the silver one, outer case in gold, and you have the bronze one.
Right.
One of which was stolen on the 28th of January. Mm-hmm. Now, the British came and they took the permission and they entered the Egyptian Museum and they blew in it and the sound is out of this world. Mm-hmm. It's a military trumpet. Mm-hmm. From where did we know? The king is carved on it wearing the Khepresh crown. And the Khepresh crown is the crown of war. Mm-hmm. So listen to the only recording in the world in the 1930s of the trumpet of Tutankhamun brought from his tomb, the original one, and still working strong.
We're going to see a video for this surprise and we'll be right back.
Now, the two trumpets will be blown by bandsman James Taffer, who is here by permission of the colonel and officers of the 11th Prince Albert's Own Hussars. I must explain that neither trumpet is easy to sound, and this is particularly true of the copper instrument. The silver one will be heard.
The trumpets of the pharaoh Tutankhamun, lord of the crowns, king of the south and north, I'm afraid.
What?
Copper trumpet.
Thank you.
And so, after a silence of over 3,000 years, these two voices out of Egypt's glorious past have gone echoing across the world.
Welcome back, and still with Mr. Bassam Shama'a, and a great surprise.
Yes.
Where's Egypt from this tremendous event?
I proposed one day to the Minister of Trade and through media that when we are celebrating Tutankhamun on 4th of November each year, we should bring the two trumpets in a private museum. We put it in the Tahrir Square, and then we move it to Luxor. Now I'm proposing this once again and adding to it. And we can make replicas, and we can sell replicas. We can make replicas of those two trumpets, two horns, and we can sell replicas. How it, this, when it was aired through BBC, it was heard by millions of people in the 1930s.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine now with the Facebook and I don't know what, and the revolution of media and so on, what will happen to the sales of those trumpets and t-shirts and so on? You have to market this well. Three, you are going to return to the fact that 3,000 years or more, you are still using a trumpet. Can you imagine the Philharmonic if you bring it to Tahrir Square, or you bring it to the in front of the Valley of the Kings outside, and the Philharmonic is playing the trumpets copies or replicas? This will make the whole world go, you know, go amazing. Mm-hmm. And that can be an attraction. Two pieces out of millions of pieces that you have of antiquities can bring you back to reason as you want. But the need is to listen to the out-of-the-box ideas, not the in-box ideas. Those two trumpets were found in a lateral room. They were not found in the main room in Tutankhamun. They were found in one of the lateral rooms, the side rooms, one of which was in a box and the other one was wrapped. And both of them, when they were found, they were found when they were fitted inside with wood, as if the ancient Egyptian man, like we do with sometimes with our shoes and so on, that we put this model thing inside, the mold inside, so that they can protect it from being crushed or grind. Also, it was said that number of, when you study the trumpets, you'll find number of deities are carved on it. So this is something to do with the sun, once again, so you can relate that. Can you imagine we do that in front of Abu Sumbul, for example? Relation between Abu Sumbul and Tutankhamun, instead of, I don't know, jumping and dancing like baboons. I mean, why? Why? What's the relation? Why every time we go abroad to market tourism, we get the girl who's covering I don't know what and wearing I don't know satin sheets and all. Who's she? Who's representing? She's not representing anybody. She's the girl from Alexandria who's walking on the Corniche. That's the song, right? The promenade of the sea. I'm Alexandrian. I'm 53 years of age. I've never seen this girl. I would love to see her one day, but I never did. Who's she? Who's she representing? Why the people in Germany, when they see this lady dancing, like, oh, we'll have to copy, we'll have to go to Egypt to see her? Of course not. Yeah, we have to wake up a little bit, and we have to ideas like that. See, they did it. They did it in the 1930s. And it was another story which was mentioned, that minutes before they started blowing in the Egyptian museum, blowing the trumpet, electricity went off the whole Egyptian museum. And that happened in candlelit parties. So they had to illuminate the whole museum or the part of the museum with torches and candlelit events. So this is an event which can attract people. Why? What happened to electricity and so on and so forth? Even in this matter of being funny, being as a sense of humor story, which happened actually. So why? Can you explain this to us? Lectures everywhere, t-shirts, copybooks and so on. We've seen it happening abroad. We've seen it happening with museums. I, in the British Museum, years ago, I bought a tie with the Rosetta Stele on it, the text of the Rosetta Stele. So, yes, we need new ideas, and here is a good example of what happened. I would market what happened in Abu Simbel. I would market it as why did it not happen.
Right, Mr. Bassam Shama'a, Egyptologist, many thanks for joining us, sir,
thank you,
and thank you for your insight.
Thank you, my dear.
Dear ladies and gentlemen,